I'm a former professional boxer, member of the Rochester Boxing Hall of Fame and Geneva Sports Hall of Fame. And, you know, in a career that lasted a decade, I've never been knocked down.
Ladies and gentlemen, This is the main event of the evening.
Let's start like light and easy and breezy. How many, show of hands, how many of you here upon your demise will be donating your brain to medical science so they can further their efforts in researching chronic traumatic encephalopathy for the betterment of humanity? How many people? We got one over here. Ray, you want to talk about commitment to a cause? The guy's donating his brain. Okay? Unbelievable.
We want to hear from Ray, but from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much to all of you. I wanted to say a quick story the other day. Yes, Andy is the chair of our fundraising committee, and we had a meeting just the other day, and we were on Zoom because we have people all over New York State, and he kept looking in the camera. He goes, "I stink at this, guys. I really stink at this. I'm not good at this." Look around the room, people. Look around the room and see what Andy Siegel has done, and Sean Cooley. This is the effort of Siegel and Cooley, and this is their dedication to brain injury survivors all over New York State. I love coming. I know a lot of people in this room. I see familiar faces, I see good friends, and I've met some new ones. And that's what it's all about, because we can do amazing things together. I thank you so much. I thank you, Andy. I thank you, Sean. I thank you, Ray. I thank you, Ray. This guy's a fighter, and you're just absolutely gonna fall in love with him when you hear his speech.
First, I want to say good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm hoping that's appropriate use of the language nowadays. I want to thank Andy Siegel for having invited me this evening to introduce our honoree, Ray Cicilline. Most of you know Andy from his commitment and legal acumen in representing those who have suffered a brain injury. However, what may not be readily apparent is the extraordinary compassion and unwavering personal dedication with which this esteemed lawyer, best-selling author, valued brain injury lecturer and advocate fights for his client. It seems appropriate to use those words considering who we're going to hear from later. It's always a humbling and inspiring experience to be invited to share and participate in the rehabilitation of patients who have suffered a life-changing traumatic brain injury. Accepting the transformation from who I was to whom I am demands enormous courage, commitment, and acceptance. It requires a firm belief that through perseverance, one can still find meaning and value in one's life. Our evening's honoree is a prime purveyor of those vital qualities. As a man of the ring, Ray has lived the words of Tolkien, the author of The Lord of the Rings. It is not the strength of the body that counts, but the strength of the spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, Ray can be.
The honor of being here for the Brain Injury Association doesn't get any better than that. And Executive Director Eileen Reardon and her dedicated staff, I mean dedicated. They made a huge difference in the quality of life for so many brain injury survivors and their families. I can't say enough. Nice round of applause for them. I'm a former professional boxer, member of the Rochester Boxing Hall of Fame and Geneva Sports Hall of Fame. And, you know, in a career that lasted a decade, I've never been knocked down. And every fight was a war. but I always prided myself with facing top ranked fighters, no bums. And several were US and Canadian national champions. But you know, the only regret as a boxer is that I didn't defeat my toughest opponent. And that opponent was a concussion. You know, there are no crutches, no swelling, no stitches, or any other visible signs of injury. And I fought this invisible opponent throughout my boxing career, not knowing what it was, or that I was in jeopardy of developing the long-term complications that I cope with today. And for many years, I've been battling Parkinson's syndrome and dementia, stage 2, dementia pugilistica. And that's a variant of chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE. And these progressive disorders are the direct result of not addressing concussion properly during my boxing career. But I take full responsibility and for my condition, and I blame no one but me. But I encourage athletes to play all sports. And I think we pretty much know that you have to address these properly. And, you know, without doing that, the only way to protect yourself is if you happen to be unfortunate to get a symptom, be honest about it. Go and have it taken care of and follow the protocol. It's there to help you. If you don't, you're gonna bump into the problems that I have. I'm not against kids playing sports, but should they get their bell rung, make sure it's taken care of. You hurt the brain, nothing else works right. And from a high honor student, never been in trouble, I started failing every course, sleeping excessively, and then I developed a resentment toward authority. I couldn't figure out why. But it was affecting, like we know today, it does affect your behavior. And I should have gotten medical attention at that time, but you just don't think it's that serious when you don't know. And my life changed after that second impact injury. You know, some athletes have to be protected from themselves. I'm one of them. My relentless determination and desire defied common sense and logic. I took the advice of a physician friend, because I was having cognitive issues. He said I should go get evaluated at a mental health clinic, which I did. And I lasted 10 days there before I walked out, not accepting any advice from a psychiatrist or any of the medication, because they didn't give me the answer I wanted. And I relied on my relentless attitude to get me through the toughest rounds before, and now I was relying on that same relentless attitude to get me through the toughest fight of my life. And there's a gentleman named Charles Swindoll, and he said it best. Life is 10% what happens to us, and 90% how we deal with it. I was having too many mental lapses, and I started getting tremors, and they sent me to the University of Rochester Neuroscience Research Center. And that's where they diagnosed me with early stage dementia and Parkinson's syndrome, the direct result of untreated concussions. So I was retired at the age of 46. But I devoted my life to make sure that this would never happen to another athlete. CTE and sports concussion research have come a long way, and I've been involved in the Legend study, the Hope study, and one other study at Boston University. And again, like Andy said, the need a jackhammer to get into this brain when it's over. But immediate honesty about any concussion symptoms will always be the best policy and protection. I've had 55 years to ponder what went wrong, and I always come back to the same conclusion. Lack of concussion education and peer pressure led to my demise. I challenged the concussion, and I got beat. It cost me my quality of life and my future potential. This is what it's like for me living with a permanent brain injury. My life now consists of not what I want to do, but what I'm capable of doing. I'm very restricted. I've had a headache every day since I was 16. I'm now 73. For many years, I slept excessively. But now I fight to get 3 hours of sleep a night. And the tremors. You know, I used to be so ashamed of my hands trembling that I'd sit on my hands when we were out in public to hide. But I don't hide anything anymore. It is what it is. And the dementia. The best way I can explain to you is it's a fog every day. There's no let up. Some days are better than others. I've never been knocked down in my entire career, and I refuse to allow dementia to be the first one to do. If this may surprise you, but if I had it all to do over again, I would still pursue a boxing career. Absolutely, it's in me. I would still compete with the same tenacity and dedication that it takes to be a champion that I never was. The only thing that I would do differently is that I would immediately get medical attention for any symptoms of injury that my body was warning me to address. With the education that we have today about concussion, the word is out and the help is there. We have to make the smart choice. And I'm still here, still grateful, and still fighting. But the one thing for sure, this is for sure, I wouldn't be standing here talking to you today if I had addressed that first concussion properly. Thank you.